Oh. Hi, my dear students. Welcome back again to our lecture. So, this is the chapter 9. It's about the start of the Filipino armed struggle. So, I want to share with you the PowerPoint presentation. Okay. So, again, this is your Sir Jibs. So I'm going to discuss with you the start of Filipino armed struggle. So what is Katipunan? Okay, the founding of Katipunan. When we talk about Katipunan, it was established when sabi nga, no, how Katipunan was established. Okay, since July 7, 1892, upon learning that Rizal was to be deported and that his work were to be banned in the country, a secret council was convened in number 72 Street, Ascaraga Street. In attendance were Andres Bonifacio, Deodato Aureliano, Valentin Diaz, we have Teodoro Plata, Ladislao Diwa, Jose Dizon, and a few others. All members of La Liga Filipina, okay? Progressive organization founded by Rizal. So the men assembled and came to the agreement that a revolutionary secret society must be founded. And thus, the kataas-taasang kagalang-galang na Katipunan ng mga anak ng bayan was born. Okay. There is a blood compact between those members of Katipunan on July 7, 1892. Okay, wherein, of course, the Katipuneros used the what we call pseudonyms or alias to hide their real identities. So we have Andres Bonifacio, he used May Pag-asa, Artemio Ricarte used Bibura, and Emilio Jacinto used the alias Pinkian. Okay. What are the missions of Katipunan? Okay. What are the missions of Katipunan? Actually, the objective of Katipunan as the Brotherhood was properly known were threefold. We have the political, second one is moral, and number three is civic. No, they advocated for freedom from the yoke of Spain to be achieved through armed struggle. So they also saw it as their personal responsibility to help poor and oppressed and to teach them good manners, hygiene, and morality. Okay. What is the what we call triangle method? This is how the Katipuneros recruit their members. Okay. Or the initiation of members, no? New recruits to the secret society actually underwent an initiation process, okay? Similar to Masonic practices, Neophyte dressed black and accompanied by his sponsor was brought to a small room decorated with patriotic posters. And in front of a cabinet wrapped in black, he was then seated at a dimly lit table on which rested a bolo, okay, a revolver, and a set of questions which he must answer to the satisfaction of the members assembled. Okay, what was the condition of the Philippines in the early times? Okay, what is the condition today? What will be the condition in the future? So those are some question na pwede natin maisip, no, when we study this part of the history about Katipunan. So we have the different ranks or ranks of the members of Katipunan. We have Katipunan, wherein their password is anak bayan. No, these the ordinary members of Katipunan. How about Kawal? Okay, their password is Gombursa. They wear a green mask hood and a sash of the same color with green ribbon to their neck. How about Bayani? Bayani, the password is Rizal. No, they are the one who wore a red mask hood and a green sash. Okay. As you observe, no, each ranks of the members of Katipunan have different password. No, para ma-identify nila, ano yung logic noon? To identify if that particular member is the real member of Katipunan. Okay? So, structure of Katipunan. So, though the organizational structure of Katipunan was constantly in flux, it is generally believed that they form small branches governed by the Sanggunian Balangay. Okay? And these small branches would form larger provincial councils governed by the Sanggunian Bayan. All this would be overseen by the Supreme Council of the Katipunan or Kataas-taasang Sanggunian, which was composed of a president or the Pangulo, secretary or kalihim, fiscal or taga-usig, treasurer or taga-ingat yaman, and the six councilor or kasangguni. Okay. So, the legislative body of the Katipunan was known as the Katipunan Assembly, and it was composed of members of Supreme Council along with the presidents of the popular and provincial councils. Judicial power rested in the Sanggunian Hukuman, which were provincial courts that decided on internal matters. However, the judgment on grave matters such as betraying the Katipunan or committing acts penalized by the organization laws were meted by the secret chamber composed of Andres Bonifacio, Emilio Jacinto, and of course, Dr. Pio Valenzuela. So, Supreme Council of Katipunan were composed of the President, of Pangulo, Kalihim, Taga-Usig, Taga-Ingat Yaman, again, and Taga-Sangguni. Okay. So, the secret structure of the Katipunan. So, though the organizational structure of the Katipunan was constantly in flux, it is generally believed that they form small branches governed by the Sanggunian Balangay. And these small branches would form larger provincial councils governed by Sanggunian Bayan. All this would be overseen by the Supreme Council of the Katipunan or Kataas-taasang Sanggunian, which was composed of a president, okay? Which was composed of a president, secretary or kalihim, fiscal or taga-usig, treasurer or ingat yaman, and the six councilors or kasangguni. Okay. So, what is Katipunan Assembly? Okay, the legislative body of the Katipunan was known as the Katipunan Assembly, and it was composed of the members of some Supreme Council along with the president of the popular and provincial councils. Okay. So, judicial power, of course, rested in the Sanggunian Hukuman, okay, which were provincial courts that decided on internal matters. However, judgment on grave matters such as betraying the Katipunan or committing acts penalized by the organization's law were committed by the secret chamber composed of Andres Bonifacio, Emilio Jacinto, and Dr. Pio Valenzuela. Okay? So, who are the leaders of Katipunan? Okay? We have the first Supreme Council on 1892 wherein the president was Diosdado Arellano, Comptroller Andres Bonifacio, Ladislao Diwa is the fiscal. Secretary is Diodoro Plata. Teodoro Plata. Treasurer is Valentin Diaz. So the Second Supreme Council was formed on 1893. Okay. Bakit? Because unsatisfied with Arellano's performance as supreme or as supremo, okay? So Bonifacio later had him deposed and supported the election of Roman Basa as supremo on February 1, 1893. That is why we have the Second Supreme Council that formed on 1893, wherein the president is Ramon Basa, fiscal as Andres Bonifacio, secretary is Jose Santiago, treasurer is Vicente Molina, councilors are Restituto Javier, Bricio Pantas, Teodoro Gonzalez, Teodoro Plata, and Ladislao Diwa. Okay. So, how about the third leaders of Katipunan, the Third Supreme Council that was formed in 1894, okay, wherein Andres Bonifacio became the supremo, and the fiscal is Emilio Jacinto, the secretary is Jose Santiago, and the treasurer is Vicente Molina. Okay, we have also the Fourth Supreme Council that was formed in 1896. Okay, or the Fifth Council, okay, Supreme Council that formed from 1896 on August 1896, no, before the or during the what we call this prior to the outbreak of the Philippine Revolution, wherein the Supremo Andres Bonifacio, we have the Secretary of State Emilio Jacinto, Secretary of War is Teodoro Plata, the Secretary of Justice is Bricio Pantas, Secretary of Interior is Aguedo del Rosario, and Secretary of Finance is Enrique Pacheco. So, list of other notable Katipuneros. So, these are some of the notable Katipuneros or members of the KKK. We have Emilio Aguinaldo, Melchora Aquino, we have Gregorio del Pilar, we have Liserio Jeronimo, we have Marcelo H. del Pilar, we have Macario Sacay, we have Miguel Balbar, Antonio Luna, Vicente Lucban, Mariano Llanera, and Emilio Jacinto. Okay. So, what is the role of women in Katipunan, or the women members of the Katipunans, or they call it La Semilla? Okay. It was during Basa's Basa's term, the Katipunan organized a women's auxiliary section called La Semilla. Okay, as early as 1892, actually, women already had their role in the secret society as Katipuneros. One of their mission was to create a diversion to mislead the Guardia Civil robbing and those passers-by within the area where the meeting of Katipunan was ongoing. Now, here were some of their nicknames. And their main role in Katipunan, they became the keepers of the most important documents of the revolutionary movement. So that is the main role of women in Katipunan. Okay? Wherein the members are spread, wherein the president of this women chapter in Katipunan, we have Josefa Rizal, no, the president. She is the sister of Jose Rizal. So Vice President Gregorio De Jesus, also known as Dalakambini of KKK, the wife of Andres Bonifacio. Okay, secretary, we have Marina Dizon. Okay. So, Marina Dizon, Santiago, the cousin of Emilio Jacinto. We have Piscal, okay? Angelica Lopez. We have Benita Rodriguez, the one who made the KKK flag. We have Melchora Aquino, or known as Tandang Sora. No? He is considered as the Katipunan first aider. Okay. We have Gregoria Montoya y Patricio. Actually, She replaced her dead husband, no, and led the 30 kateponeros. Okay? We have again the kahabagan. Yes, he led a katipunan group also. And Teresa Magbanwa, known as the Joan of Arc of the Visayas. And Rosario Lopez, supporting katipuneros by finance and goods. We have Delfina Herbosa and Trinidad Rizal. Okay. So, in 1893, actually, Basa and Diwa organized Provincial Council of Cavite, which later became the most successful council of the society. So on January 5, 1894, the leadership of Katipunan changed for the third time, no? Wherein the officers were the following, no? Katulad ng binanggit ko kanina, wherein Supremo became Andres Bonifacio, the secretary is Jose Santiago, the fiscal is Emilio Cinto, and Vicente Molina became the treasurer. Okay? So, what else? So, what are the literatures in Katipunan? Of course, no? Sumikat during that Katipunan time, sumikat itong mga different literatures na to o yung mga babasahin. Okay? So, like Andres Bonifacio is the one who wrote the Pag-ibig sa Tinibuang Lupa. Okay? He also wrote the Decalogue of Katipunan or the Duties of the Son of the People and Ang Mabatid ng Mga Tagalog. Okay. Emilio Jacinto, he is also known as the brain of Katipunan. Why he is considered as the brain of Katipunan? Because he's the one who wrote, no, the Cartilla. Cartilla is the Bible of KKK. Just remember that. Cartilla is the Bible of KKK. We have separate additional lecture with regards to Cartilla or KKK. No? Kasi maganda talaga yung nilalaman itong Cartilla'ng to. Emilio Jacinto also wrote the Liwanag at Dilim. No? It is a series of articles about human rights, liberty, equality, labor, and love of country. No? He also wrote the La Patria, just like Rizal Farewell to My Fatherland, Ami Madre to My Mother. Okay? Where in Dr. Pio Valenzuela, no, he helped editing the articles of Bonifacio and Jacinto. And he also wrote, no, his contribution was Katwiran and Sa Mga Kababayan. Okay? What is kalayaan? Ipropaganda movement have different newspaper, or the main newspaper of propaganda movement is main newspaper of propaganda movement again? Very good. That is La Solidaridad. Okay. In Katipunan, we have the counterpart of the newspaper. We have the Kalayaan. Remember that. Okay? Propaganda, La Solidaridad. Katipunan, we have Kalayaan newspaper. Okay? Newspaper of Katipunan where Emilio Jacinto is the editor-in-chief. But he used the name of Marcelo H. Del Pilar. And he put Yokohama, Japan as the place of publication. Why? Why Emilio Jacinto? No? Who is the editor-in-chief of this newspaper, Kalayaan? Use the name of Marcelo and H. Del Pilar. And he put Yokohama, Japan as the place of publication. What do you think is the reason behind? Okay? Think? Okay? Very good. Okay? Alam ko yung nasa isip ninyo. Okay? Hindi nyo palang sinasabi pero alam ko na yan. Okay? Kasi kailangan nilang maligaw ang mga Espanyol. No? Kasi nga, if they are in the Yokohama, Japan, no? There is no access, no, yung Spaniards sa Japan. Okay? And hindi nila mahuhuli basta-basta kung sino ba talaga ang nagpapakalat nitong newspaper na ito, if ever man na makita ito ng mga Espanyol. So that's the reason. Okay? The contributors of this newspaper also use different pseudonyms or nicknames or alias. Like Emilio Jacinto, he used Dimas Ilaw. Andres Bonifacio, he used Agap Ito, Bagong Bayan. Pio Valenzuela, Madlang Awa. And Jose Rizal, of course, used the nickname Laong Laan. Okay. So, what is the first cry of the Philippine independence? Actually, may kwento dito, no? Sinasabi sa kasaysayan kanina na when Bonifacio and his men explored the forests or the mountains in Montalban, Rizal, in search of good hideout, where they could hold their secret meetings. No, on April 10, 1895, Bonifacio and his companion entered the what we call Cape of Bernardo Carpio, or known as the Pamitunan Cape. Actually, pagpunta ka ng Rizal sa Montalban, pwede nilang ituro sa inyo yung tinatawag nilang Pamitunan Cave. Noon kasi pinapapasokan to, pero right now hindi na. Kasi nga pinipreserve yung loob, no? Okay. This Pamitunan Cave of Andres Bonifacio, no? Kung saan sinasabi na in this particular sa cave na ito, Aurelio Tolentino wrote by using charcoal the words Viva la Independencia Pilipinas, wherein in our history it is known as the first cry of Katipuneros. Okay? So, how Katipunan was discovered? Okay? Actually, sinasabi sa kasaysayan na there is a story, no, na kung saan there is a misunderstanding between Apolonio de la Cruz and Teodoro Patiño, wherein it led to the discovery of Katipunan. So their misunderstanding, okay? So that misunderstanding, no, ito noong August 19, 1896, upon the advice of the mother fortress of Mandaluyong Orphanage and his sister Honoria, Teodoro Patiño, no, sa sobrang sama kasi ng loob ni Teodoro Patiño, no, na ikwento niya sa kanyang kapatid na si Honoria yung tungkol sa Katipunan or the secret organization na to or society na binuo nila Andres Bonifacio. Si Honoria ay nagtatrabaho sa tinatawag nating orphanage. So, wala naman sa isip ni Honoria na naikwento niya ito sa kanyang Mother Superiora. Okay? Of course, since the Mother Superiora, no, is of course a Spaniard, okay? Nakapagsumbong ito ngayon or nakapagkwento ngayon itong Mother Superiora doon sa pare. Okay? And pinatawag itong si Teodoro Patiño. Sabi diyan, Teodoro Patiño went to the convent of Tondo and revealed the secret of Katipunan to Father Mariano Hill. And of course, Father Mariano Hill is the key para kaya nabisto ang ating secret na organization, which is Katipunan. Okay? So, actually, sinasabi sa kasaysayan ang nag-discover itong Katipunan nito, no? Talagang pinuntahan nila, they went doon sa mismong printing press kung saan ginagawa yung dyaryong kalayaan at yung ibang mga dokumento ng Katipunan, no? And doon ang karating sila doon, ay nakita nga nila ang mga dokumento na talagang may existing nga na ganitong organization sa Pilipinas. So after the tragic discovery of Katipunan, Emilio Jacinto and many Katipuneros had to escape the dragnet of Spanish law and flee to Caloocan and its neighboring barrio. So on August 26, 1896, Katipuneros met at Pugad Lawit and they agreed to fight for independence. So they tore their cedulas. They tore their cedulas and they shouted, "Long live Philippine independence." Okay. So, we have a separate lecture. Saan nga ba itong Pugad Lawi na ito? Kasi ang dami nagkiklaim. Meron sa Caloocan. Meron dito sa part ng Quezon City. Meron din sa Manila. Okay? Tingnan natin. No, pag-aaralan natin yun sa mga susunod nating aralin, no, yung extra lecture natin. Saan nga ba naganap itong Pugad Lawi? Itong cry of Pugad Lawi na ito. Okay. So we have the first Filipino in Spanish encounter on August 30, 1896, no? It became the first encounter of Katipuneros and Spanish troops happened in San Juan del Monte. They attacked the Spanish arsenal and tried to get their arms stuck there, but they were failed. Okay. After the battle in San Juan Bonifacio, his men refuged to the hills at the junction of Marikina and San Mateo and Montalban, Rizan. So after the discovery of the Katipunan, we have the what we call the Reign of Terror, wherein on August 30, 1896, after the morning, no, Governor Ramon Blanco declared martial law, no, in 8 provinces. No, these 8 provinces, they represent the 8 golden rays of the sun in the present Filipino flag or Philippine flag. Ano-ano yung mga probinsya yon? We have Manila, Cavite, Batangas, Laguna, Tarlac, Nueva Ecija, and Bulacan, and the province of Pampanga. Okay. So, other leaders of Katipunan who joined the revolution were Macario Sacay, Faustino Guillermo, Apolonio Samson, and General Lucero. Okay. On August 31, 1896, Aguinaldo defeated the Spaniards, Spanish Guardia Civil. Okay. And on September 4, 1896, Sancho Valenzuela, Eugenio Silvestre, Modesto Sarmiento, and Ramon Peralta were executed in Luneta. Okay? That is why this is called the Reign of Terror. Kasi after the discovery of Katipunan, sunod-sunod na ang pagpatay nila at paghahanting nila sa mga hinahinala nila at pinagbibintangan nila na ito ay mga miyembro ng Katipunan. On September 13, 1896, 13 martyrs in Cavite executed, no, the Los 13 Martires. Okay? So we have on November 11, 1896, the greatest victory of Emilio Aguinaldo against Governor Blanco troops, no, also known as the Binakayan Battle. Okay? And on the December 30, 1896, okay, Dr. Cerizal was executed, no, in Bagumbayan, which is Luneta Park right now. Okay? And January 4, 1897, 12 Bicolanos in were executed. No, makikita nyo to sa Daet, meron silang monumento doon, the 12 Bicolanos who were executed, no, in Bicol region. So, we have on March 23, 1897, 19 martyrs in Aklan also executed. Okay? How about the revolution? What happened in the revolution in Cavite? So, sabi nga sa kasaysayan, no? Sinasabi nga sa kasaysayan that there is internal struggle of Katipunan, okay? In the development of the revolution against Spain, no, Katipunan in Cavite established 2 factions, the Magdalo and Magdiwang faction. Okay? So, in the revolution in Cavite, may existing na nakikilala tayong na leader ng Katipunan. Who are the leaders ng Katipunan in Cavite? We have Emilio Aguinaldo. We have Artemio Ricarte and Tomas Mascardo. Okay? So, these are some of the successful battle of Emilio Aguinaldo. That is the reason behind. Bakit ba nakilala ito si Emilio Aguinaldo during the time ng Katipunan? No? We have, yung mga battle na panalo ni Aguinaldo ay ang Imus Battle, Novella Battle, and the very famous Binakayan Battle. Okay. Provinces joined the revolution on September 1896 where the province of Cavite, Batangas, Bulacan, Nueva Ecija. Okay. So the conflict between Bonifacio and Aguinaldo. Okay. So sabi nga natin sa kasaysayan, no, in the development of the revolution against Spain, Katipunan in Cavite, no, established 2 factions. The Magdiwang faction led by General Mariano Alvarez and the Magdalo faction led by Baldomero Aguinaldo, the Gasing of General Emilio Aguinaldo. So they fighting a common enemy but not helping each other in fighting the war against the Spaniard. Okay? The Supremo of Andres Bonifacio was invited, no, to visit Cavite to personally settle the dispute between the Magdiwang and the Magdalo faction. By the way, the headquarters of Magdalo faction were located at Cavite, was located at Kawit, Cavite. The headquarter of Magdiwang Faction is located or was located in Nobileta, Cavite. Okay. So sabi nga natin, no, Supremo Aguinaldo was invited to visit Cavite to personally settle the dispute between Magdiwang and the Magdalo. So some historians said that the root of misunderstanding of the two factions was their pride. Most of the members of Magdalo were elite with profession in the society, while the Magdiwang members were more ordinary persons in the community, no, like farmers, they were carpenters and fishermen. Plus, the different political views of Andres Bonifacio and Emilio Aguinaldo. Okay? So, after setting the problems of two faction members of Magdalo, tried to show a proposal to Supremo to formalize their group from Katipunan to a formation of a revolutionary form of government that can symbolize Philippine independence over the colonial Spain. Okay? So, Andres Bonifacio liked the and approved the proposal as the Supremo. He ordered the immediate execution of the said plan. Okay? So, what happened? And in a convention in the first convention was happened in the what we call Imus Convention. It was happened on December 31, 1896, no, to settle the issue. The issue they want to settle is the type of government they would establish. Of course, Aguinaldo and his followers favored the establishment of revolutionary government, no? They want to what? To tanggalin na, to delete na, to abolish the Katipunan government and change it to revolutionary form of government. But Bonifacio and his followers, of course, they wanted Katipunan as to remain as a form of government. Okay? They have different ideology in terms of politics. Okay? So, sabi nga, no, at the at the convention in Tejeros or Cavite on March 22, 1897, members of Magdalo and Magdiwang assembled to form revolutionary government. Before the election started, they all agreed that what? That they agreed that whatever will be the result of the election, okay, or the convention, everybody needs to accept and respect the outcome of it. So there, Bonifacio lost his bid for the presidency to Emilio Aguinaldo and the vice presidency to Artemio Ricarte of the revolutionary government. Instead, he was elected Secretary of the Interior, no? So, a certain Daniel Terona, members of the Magdalo faction, stood and questioned the qualification of Andres Bonifacio as uneducated. For him, Bonifacio is unfit for the position, and Terona was recommending somebody from Magdalo to replace Andres Bonifacio. Of course, tao lang si Andres Bonifacio. Ano nangyari? Ano naramdaman ni Andres Bonifacio? Nasaktan si Andres Bonifacio. Sumama talaga ang loob niya. Kaya yung iba, di ba nakikita niyo sa mga palabas, bumunod siya ng baril, tinutukan niya si Daniel, ang akma niya, babarilin si Daniel Terona. Okay? So, sabi nga, upon hearing the motion of Terona, Andres Bonifacio reiterated their agreement before they conducted the said convention. What is that? To accept and respect the result. Because of the tremendous anger to Daniel Terona by claiming that he was still Supremo of Katipunan, he declared the result of the convention as null and void. And with his followers, they walked out from the Tejeros Convention. Okay? So, yun yung tinatawag nating the Naik Declaration on March 23, 1897. So, sabi nga ni Andres Bonifacio, he declared that the non-recognition of the result of the election held in the Tejeros Convention, wherein he also declares the establishment of new government different from revolutionary government and formed a separate army headed by General Pio del Pilar. So, sabi nga natin, no, kung mapapansin natin, without the knowledge of the Supremo, the Magdalo didn't acknowledge the declaration of Andres Bonifacio. Instead, Baldomero Aguinaldo, Baldomero and Emilio's brother Crispin Aguinaldo fetch him in the battlefield in Pasong San Paul to inform General Emilio Aguinaldo about his presidency. Saan ka naman kasi nakakita, no? Nanalo ang presidente pero wala naman dun sa event. Okay? They asked him to go to Tejeros for his immediate oath of office as the formal president of the new Philippine Revolutionary Government. So, the Tejeros Convention conflict, Bonifacio's decision to come to Cavite to mediate the conflicts of the two factions of Katipunan was the beginning of his downfall. Actually, Andres Bonifacio and Emilio Aguinaldo respected and valued each other. Since no, the head talaga ng Katipunan is none other than Andres Bonifacio. Okay? It was the Supremo who admitted Aguinaldo into the Katipunan. In the memoir written by Emilio Aguinaldo, he wrote that was the beginning of my acquaintance and friendship with Andres Bonifacio. He recalled when he was informed of what happened to Andres Bonifacio in the Battle of Pinaglabanan. So Aguinaldo became so worried and immediately he sent his men to look for the Supremo in the forest of Malabon and Caloocan and rescue them. But the friendship turned to become sour on the later part between the two leaders of Katipunan. Okay. So, syempre, sa political system, katulad na nangyayari ngayon, so, no, sa Diyos ko, Lord, alam niyo, sa totoo lang, ayoko sabihin sana, to, hindi ko alam kung ire-record ko pa to, no? Pero kasi na-stress ako dun sa nangyayari ngayon sa Congress natin. Saan ka naman nakakita? Diyos, ewan ko, no? I mean, I don't know, no? Kung ano, ayoko na lang mag-comment, okay? Na-stress lang ako. So, the Supremo, Supremo Andres Bonifacio and his Katipunero suffered many defeats at the hands of Spaniards in Manila. While Emilio Aguinaldo managed to win a war against their common enemy in most areas of Cavite province. So, possible factors why Andres Bonifacio and his group lost most of their battle in Manila. Number one, of course, they do not have the experience to engage the war. Number two, they do not have enough guns and ammunition to fight, of course. And number three, they were fighting near the center of power of their enemy, which was in Intramuros, Manila. So what are the possible factors? Why naman Emilio Aguinaldo and his group won most of their battle in Cavite? Number one, most of the members of Aguinaldo group were educated elites. They can contribute a good political and war strategy. Number two, forces of the enemy were few compared to those in Manila. And number three, Cavite was far from the center of power of their enemy for reinforcement of men and ammunition. So in those days and even today, the feeling of regionalism between the two leaders from Tondo, Manila, and from Cavite, Cavite, was very strong. Aside from having a contradicting political views, in other words, at this point in our history, there were two leaders with two different views on how to run the government. Hindi naman natin talaga naalis yun, okay? So, the trial execution of Bonifacio brother. So actually, no, may sinasabing may kwento pa kasi dito, no? Nagpapagod ako magkwentos lang. So the arrest of Supremo, no? From the disagreement of Supremo Andres Bonifacio of the result of the Tejeros Convention. So the relationship of the two leaders started to break up. So Emilio Aguinaldo took his oath office as the president of the first Philippine Revolutionary Government because Andres Bonifacio didn't like to acknowledge the said government of President Emilio Aguinaldo. And he continued to act as a supremo of the Katipunan without the knowledge of Andres Bonifacio. So some Cavite Katipuneros like Daniel Terona, Severino de las Alas, and Colonel Jose Coronel spread rumors about the Supremo. Okay? They also filed formal complaints, okay, to President Aguinaldo, no, wherein the charges were as follows: that Andres Bonifacio and was contracted and paid by priors to organize an anti-Spanish called Katipunan. Ang dami kasing chismosa. Nag-exist ang chismosa talaga during this time. No, number two, ano pa yung number two natin? So, Andres Bonifacio directly ordered his men to burn churches and convent under Spanish pueblos. Okay, number three, Andres Bonifacio forcibly stole the carabaos and the cows of those people who do not like him to help them for their food. Andres Bonifacio misspent most of the funds of the Katipunan. And number five, Andres Bonifacio planned to surrender the Katipunan to the Spaniards. So these are some of the ideas, no, or murmurs, chismis of the some members of Katipunan who are very close to the President Emilio Aguinaldo. Now, until now, no, as we observe our government, until now that is existing in our government, no? Merong ano, alam mo yon, sila-sila na nga magkakampi, sila-sila pa nag-aaway. Okay? So, when President Aguinaldo received the charges against Andres Bonifacio, he immediately sent his men through Colonel Agapito Bonson and Jose Ignacio Pawa, no, and their men to arrest the Supremo in Limbon, Indang. On their arrival at the said place, unexpectedly, they've seen the Supremo face to face and had a conversation on where they will go. And the Supremo himself replied that they will go to the Silang for a group reconnaissance, and they parted ways. But the following morning, Colonel Bonson and Pawa went back to the place of the Supremo, and surprisingly, they started to fire their guns into the Supremo's troops who were on duty, and from there, si Riaco Bonifacio was killed. He is the eldest brother of Andres Bonifacio. After they attacked other Bonifacio's men on the place and disarmed all of them. When Andres Bonifacio and his other brother, Procorpio, together with their remaining forces, heard the gunshots, no, or the gunshots, they immediately approached the place of a heavy revolver and wounded the Supremo into his upper left arm. And Pawa, who was also there and seen that Andres was already wounded, no, with the knife in his hand, he attacked and stabbed the Supremo, and that went into his neck. When Pawa will have another strike, okay, to Andres Bonifacio to finally kill him, a certain Alejandrino Santiago quickly toss himself to Pawa and wrestled him while shouting to Pawa, "Kill me, not him." That moment saved Andres Bonifacio. Okay. Because of Andres Bonifacio's gunshot and stab wounds, he got weak to stand and to walk. They put him into hammock with his brother Procopio and their men. They were arrested and held prisoners. On April 29, 1897, all of them brought to the military tribunal in Naik, Cavite. Okay. How the trials of execution of Bonifacio brother happened? Okay. Actually, after the arrest of President Emilio Aguinaldo, forwarded the case to the his military tribunal or the Council of War that time, no? So to investigate the charges against the Bonifacio brothers, Andres Bonifacio and of course Procopio Bonifacio. The following were the members of the Philippine Council that conduct the investigation. Okay? So we have Jerem Noriel, the chairman, so on, members is Crisosto Muriel, Tomas Moscado, Placido Marines, Mariano Rayo de Dios, Esteban Ipante, and Sulpicio Antonio. Okay. So these were the members of the Council of War. Okay. So, in spite of the fact that the evidence was not sufficient to prove the alleged, of course, the alleged accusations and guilt to the two Bonifacio brothers, their verdict was guilty of treason and sedition. And in August, within five days, kinunbik na nila or hinatulan nila ang Bonifacio brothers na sedition and what you call this and treason and sedition. Okay, so on May 8 actually Baldomero Aguinaldo, the auditor of war, wrote President Emilio Aguinaldo to recommend the approval of the decision made by the tribunal, which was execution of the Bonifacio brothers. But according to some historians, President Aguinaldo still considered his previous friendship, no, and admiration to Andres, so he must commuted the death sentence to exile. That information reached the attention of General Mariano Noriel and Pio del Pilar, and instantly they went directly to President Aguinaldo and asked him to withdraw his order of exile. Okay, they convinced the President Aguinaldo that Andres Bonifacio was a living threat and can be the cause of what? Disunity of the forces of revolutionary government. So the prayer of the two generals to President Aguinaldo were immediately supported by Clemente Jose Zulueta, Dr. Anastasio Francisco, and General Mameto Natividad, no? Wherein these persons are hated Andres Bonifacio or the Supremo. Okay? So what else? So in his letter bearing his signature, Aguinaldo said that while he's initially commuted actually the brother's death sentence to banishment, he was prevailed upon by his General Mariano Noriel and Pio del Pilar, who were part of his Council of War, to carry out the execution for the country's sake. Aside from the names mentioned, more personalities also inspired Emilio Aguinaldo to render the execution of the two Bonifacio brothers. They were Feliciano Loxon, Antonio Montenegro, Teodoro Gonzalez, Severino de las Alas, Baldomero Aguinaldo, and Mariano Trias. So the original decision of the Council of War remained. According to some historians, it was the system of the elites or elite democracy that executed the Supremo Andres Bonifacio. So many people said that we cannot directly blame Aguinaldo for his decision because he was also a victim of circumstances. Emilio Aguinaldo was only 28 at that time, so he rendered the decision still young to become the president of a country. His only related experience were Cabeza de Barangay of Binacayan, Governor Darcilio and Capitan Municipal of Cavite El Viejo, and the president advisors were traditional and aged politician. Okay, the execution of the two brothers, okay? So on May 10, 1897, the Supremo Andres Bonifacio and his brother Procopio Bonifacio were executed by firing squad at Mount Nagpatong, Mount Buntis, at Mount Maragondon at Cavite by Major Lazaro Macapagal upon the orders of General Noriel. Okay. So that is the end of the life of Andres Bonifacio. But upon searching the body of Andres Bonifacio, no, upon searching the body of Andres Bonifacio, until now, hindi siya pa siya nakikita. No, kung nagpunta kayo dyan sa Maragondon, Cavite, no, nag-field trip na kami dyan last time, sobrang nga lang init kasi nag-hiking kami dyan. Okay? Pero sinasabi natin sa kasaysayan na until now, siya yung isa sa bayani na hindi pa nakikita ang tunay na bangkay. Bakit? Kasi according to some historians, yung mga nakasaksi noon, ang ginawa doon sa kanyang libingan, tinabunan lang nila ng mga dried leaves, no? Tinabunan lang nila ng mga tawag dito, ng mga tuyong ano yun, yung mga sanga-sanga, no? At wala silang iniwang tanda kung saan makikita yung pinaglibingan kay Andres Bonifacio at sa kanyang kapatid, no? Kaya yung makikita niyo ano doon, makikita niyo yung libingan doon sa Maragondon, Cavite ni Andres Bonifacio. Wala talaga nalaman yun kasi until now we have some question kung talaga ba yung nakita nila ba doon, talaga bang yun ba talaga ang labi ni Andres Bonifacio or hindi. Kasi actually nagkaroon pa ng political ano dito, si naglaban kasi ito sa presidency si Manuel L. Quezon, si Emilio Aguinaldo. And President Manuel L. Quezon used the death of Andres Bonifacio, no? Kung paano pinatay si Andres Bonifacio para manalo sa kanilang eleksyon, sa kanilang sa pagtakbo bilang presidente ng Pilipinas, no? Kaya natalo doon panahon na yon si Emilio Aguinaldo. Okay. So I hope you learned something, and if you have some questions, no, we will have our consultation schedule, and please do not forget to answer your module and read also your module. And again, do not forget to subscribe to my channel. Hang yun erong solong gala. Again, this is your Sir Gibbs. Mabuhay tayong lahat. Bye bye.
Okay, so good afternoon. So, pipilisan na natin yung mga natin. So, we don't have